In this video, we're given an RLC circuit, and we know the value of the inductance is 33 millihenries, and we're told that inductor has negligible resistance. Our resistor has 4.5 ohms resistance, our capacitor is 40 microfarads, and we have this sinusoidal voltage applied to the circuit with an RMS value of 3.0 volts. And we're asked 5 different questions in this circuit. We want the resonant frequency, the RMS current at the resonant frequency, the inductive and capacitive reactances, and the RMS current when I'm away from the resonant frequency at 200 hertz. And I'll start by summarizing some of the formulas that we're going to use as we answer these questions. So first off, when we're dealing with alternating current, we use the word impedance instead of resistance. And the impedance is the effective resistance of a circuit with an alternating current running through it. And so there's the formula for impedance, and it has the ordinary resistance in there, the square root of R squared, plus the term that accounts for the effective resistance of the inductor and the capacitor. And this is the way the impedances add up. You have to take the difference between the contribution from the inductor, which is called the inductive reactance, and the contribution from the capacitor, that's called the capacitive reactance, and you square that inside the square root before you add to the square of the resistance. And those effective resistances or reactances for the inductor and the capacitor, those are frequency-dependent quantities. An inductor will give you more resistance if you hit it with a higher frequency because inductors resist changes in current. And that one is given by the formula 2 pi F times the inductance. Our capacitive reactance, capacitors have lower resistance if you hit them with a high frequency, because if you hit them with a high frequency, they can't build up very much charge to resist the flow of current. And I'll go ahead and post a link to the video where resonance in an RLC circuit was first discussed. But the idea behind the resonant frequency for an RLC circuit is that there's one special frequency for which the capacitive and inductive reactances are equal. That makes this part of the impedance term vanish. It makes the impedance its minimum possible value and you get the maximum possible current. If you set the inductive and capacitive reactance equal and solve for the frequency, that's the resonant frequency that maximizes the current in the circuit. And I'm just going to quote the formula for it here. All right, so there's our summary of all the tools we're going to use. Let's get into the parts of the problem. So first I want the resonant frequency for the circuit, and that's just a matter of quoting the formula I just wrote down. So 1 over 2 pi square root of LC. L is 33 millihenries. I'm going to change that into 0.033 henries. C was 40 microfarads, so 40 times 10 to the negative 6. And when I run the numbers on this, I get 139 hertz, keeping 3 sig figs as a matter of convention. In part B, I want the root mean squared, or RMS current, at the resonant frequency. And so the current follows a version of Ohm's law, I equals V over R, and the RMS current is given by the RMS voltage divided by the total resistance. But in an alternating current circuit, we use the total impedance. But things get simpler here because, as I said, at the resonant frequency of 139 hertz, there's no calculation necessary to get the impedance because I know at the resonant frequency, the two reactances are equal to each other, and that term in the impedance vanishes. So as long as we're at the resonant frequency, the total impedance is equal to the square root of R squared, which is just the resistance in the circuit. So I have my 3.0 volts RMS divided by my impedance, which turns out to just be equal to the resistance, which was 4.7 ohms. And I've got my RMS current. This turns out to be 0.638 amps. Next, we're going to hit this circuit with a 200 hertz signal. So that's quite a bit above the resonant frequency. We should expect to see a smaller current resulting from that. And this time we do need to carefully compute the total impedance. So we start by getting the inductive reactance. Again, that's 2 pi FL, 2 pi times 200 times our inductance, which was 0.033. This gives me an inductive reactance of 41.5 ohms. Remember, the reactance of a circuit element is its effective resistance. Then we want the capacitive reactance, and we plug into the formula for that. So we have 1 over 2 pi times the frequency we're driving this thing at, that's 200 hertz, times our capacitance, which was 40 microfarads, or 40 times 10 to the negative 6. We run the numbers on this and get 19.9 ohms for the reactance. And then finally, we want the RMS current when we drive this circuit at 200 hertz with a 3 volt signal. So we need to get the total impedance. That's our effective resistance for the circuit. And that starts with R squared. That's 4.7 squared. And then we have this term with the difference of the inductive and capacitive reactances. It doesn't matter what order you put them in because we're going to square it. And when I run the numbers on this, I get 22.1 ohms. Now the RMS current is simply found from Ohm's law. So IRMS is V over R. But again, instead of a simple R, we use a Z for impedance. And I have this 3-volt signal that we're applying to the circuit. And I'm dividing by this total impedance of 22.1 ohms. And when I run the numbers, I get 0.136 amps. And as we expected, this is a lower amount of current than we got when we were driving the circuit at its resonant frequency. At the resonant frequency, we're maximizing the current for the particular voltage that we're applying to the circuit. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.